Good afternoon, everybody. So I would like to begin this session with one little story. My story. One day when we were in Noida, Delhi, we were taking a walk, me and my daughter. And there was a group of monkeys. And somebody pelted stones on them. And what happened is, we were the perfect target for these monkeys. Now the people who pelted stones on them, the monkeys couldn't attack them again. And they saw this mother-daughter duo. My daughter was just 4 years old at that time, and I had a broken ankle and wasn't really able to walk properly. I was limping. And we were in the corner of the park, and around 8-ish, the morning walk, people were waning. So we were the perfect target. And there was this group of 15, 20 monkeys basking in the Dilli ki sardi, in the warm morning sun. And when they saw that we are the perfect target and they couldn't attack the people who attacked them, the entire group of monkeys started walking towards us slowly. And my daughter started screaming on top of her lungs. And I really wasn't thinking consciously. However, when the monkeys started coming, with the very hurt knee of mine, with the very hurt leg of mine, I kicked the monkey, which hurtled quite a distance. And by the time my daughter went behind me, and by the time I turned, and there was another monkey who was about to bite my daughter, its mouth was like that on my daughter's ankle. So I turned and kicked that monkey, and my daughter all along was screaming. And her screams weren't really registering in my mind, because probably my thought was, how do I save my daughter? Or how do I, you know, save ourselves, you know, from these group of monkeys? By the time people had heard the screams and a lot of people came and pelted stones and, you know, we were saved, we went home safely and sound. So when I was thinking about today's topic, our subconscious mind, the miracle factory of our mind, who was that person within me who reacted with such a presence of mind in spite of a broken ankle? And the first thing, after almost an hour, my daughter said that, "Mom, you were not scared." She was closest to me, and till then she had it in her mind that my mother cannot even run, she cannot even walk. How will she be able to save me? And then I was able to face these monkeys. And in this incident, what happened is, my daughter's confidence in me was restored. That though her mother may be limping, though the mother is, you know, invalid in a sense. And I also realized a lot of different patterns. During that time, when I was limping, there were so many things, that sentences that I kept on saying was, "I can't do this, I can't do that, I can't run with you in the park because... I can't do this because..." And when this particular incident came, I behaved, I reacted, I showed up. Yeah. So, who and what was this person? Yes. So, and that is the story I thought I will share with you today from my own life. And about the subconscious mind, I would really like to share some really interesting things. So, let us consider this as an iceberg. And this is the tip of the iceberg. So this is our conscious mind, and this entire thing is our subconscious mind. So today we are going to talk about the workings of the subconscious mind and how powerful it is and how it really works through us, many times unconsciously, many times without we even giving it any instructions. So what is the subconscious mind? And before we go there, I would like to introduce myself. I am Rohini Gupta, founder of Dream Manifestors, which is a company which trains people in the power of subconscious mind and really helps them to fulfill and realize their own dreams. And today with you, I'm going to share the similar power, the amazing power of subconscious mind that I have learned to love as well. Yeah. So let us start right away. So this is the tip of the iceberg of our mind, which we are actually using, the 5% of our mind. That is our intellectual mind, the conscious mind that we actually use. And this is the entire subconscious mind, which is almost 95% that we do not use. And even in this, there are different stages. So this is the beta stage. This is the alpha stage. So what is the alpha stage? It is the expanded awareness. It is a state of expanded awareness. Yeah? So in this expanded awareness, what do we do best? Our creativity. Creativity springs out of this mind. Ideas that we come up with, they come out of this state, which is the alpha state. Next is the theta stage of the mind. This is the record of our memory. It's the memory record. This is where also the meditation happens. And this is also where we get the intuitive flashes, right? And this is the delta, which is the deep sleep or the healing stage. This is the stage where our body heals itself. Yeah. So if we were to represent it in the terms of electrical pulses per second, then this beta stage, the conscious stage, would probably look something like this. The alpha stage would probably look something like this. The theta would probably look something like this. And the delta would be, and this is the end. As we see in most of the movies, if they have to really depict somebody is no more, that line will just go straight. So that is something which we don't want to reach right now at all. Yeah. So this entire subconscious mind, it stores everything. Please do come. Thank you. So the subconscious mind, how does it store the data? How does it keep the memory record and all? It keeps everything in the form of feelings and emotions. So the entire subconscious mind, so most of the time we operate only from this area. So just imagine if we are able to tap this reservoir, the 95% of the reservoir, then how, from where and how much better would we be able to perform, right? Now there is a little problem. If we store everything in picture form, if we store it in the if everything is stored in emotional form or picture form, who has seen a mind? How is the picture of the mind? We don't really know the picture of the mind. So if I ask you to imagine, the television in your home, can you recall the picture immediately?
It's an object
and you know exactly where it is located in your home, right? So it has come to your mind. But when I say mind, what comes to your mind? Maybe the brain?
Brain is an organ.
Correct. Brain is an organ, not a mind. So I have studied this from Mr. Bob Proctor's lectures, and he got this from a book by Mr. Thurman, where he has given a picture for the mind. Because mostly we do not have a picture. Till then there was no pictorial form of the mind. So he has made a stick picture. So I'm going to make a little depiction here. So this is the conscious mind, this is the subconscious mind, and this is the human body. So this is the depiction of it. So this is where, so this is our mind, which dictates our body, our actions. Are we in agreement on that? That our actions are subject of our mind. Our actions are dictated by our mind, right? Now, the conscious mind works with the five senses. Would somebody like to give me the senses?
Eyes.
Yeah, eyes. So vision, ears is audio,
taste,
touch, which is the kinesthetic, and smell, that's right, thank you. So this is the smell, so nose maybe, smell. Okay, so mostly, how do we, though all the tastes matter, okay, whenever we try to taste something, so if I ask you to remember, we all grew up with blackboards and chalks most of the time. So if I ask you to imagine a chalk just screeching on the board, can we all feel it? That irritation of that chalk screeching on that or grating on that board, and we actually feel irritated, and there is a bodily reaction. We feel it on the skin, our teeth, they start, you know, they actually feel that. So that, how does it happen? What happened? We actually visualized it. We actually heard the sound. We even tasted it. It really gave us a very irritating feeling. And the kinesthetic or the touch, the kinesthetic is the feeling that we get because of all this, that kind of irritation that we felt. And in this case, the smell is not valid. So most of the time, the subconscious mind stores everything in audio, visual and kinesthetic, which in NLP is in short form, it is called VAK. So most of our mind works on VAK. Now what happens? The conscious mind takes all the input through all these five senses, and all the data is stored over here in the subconscious mind. So the conscious mind is the intelligent mind. And the subconscious mind is actually the servant, or actually the watchman. Why the watchman? Because the job of our subconscious mind, it actually takes in, the moment we are born, we don't have anything. We don't have any senses. But the moment we are born, we start absorbing everything. The touch, the smells, this, all the five senses, and whatever comes in our environment without any control is stored in this subconscious mind. So if you remember, at this age also, we may forget something which we said just 2 minutes back. But we remember things when we were much younger. And how do we remember all the instances? We remember them in audio, visual and kinesthetic form. We can probably see the people, we can probably hear the words, we can probably, you know, and the colors are so bright, we can actually see, visualize, hear, right? So, and feel that feeling also. The most joyful and the most disturbing memories, we can feel as if they're happening right now, or we can see them in front of our eyes, as if it's playing on this TV screen, right? So, the subconscious mind has the storage of all this. Now, why is it this watchman? The story that I narrated to you, who was the person within me who actually saved myself and my daughter? Now, the subconscious mind, age old, from the stone ages, it was trained for flight, freeze or fight. Any situation that we face, our subconscious mind will be in a hurry to protect us. It will either fight, it will freeze, or it will flight, run away. It will ask us to run. So now in this case, when there was this huge group of monkeys, running was impossible. So my subconscious mind decided to fight. I couldn't have thought so much, there wasn't that much time. And instead of freezing, it fought. Now about freezing, I have a very, I have an incident when I was in college and when I was in Pune. There is this train, I think Deccan Queen. It starts from Pune station, and I used to be on Shivajinagar railway station, which is right after Pune station. And when we would stand there, this Deccan Queen used to pass just before our local, 5 or 10 minutes before our local train came. And there was this person who was trying to cross the railway track, not from the overhead bridge, from on the tracks. And the moment he jumped, we could hear the train, and it was really very scary. Even today I can feel that train, you know, hurtling down, and it's pretty scary. So we could actually feel the train, we could feel the vibrations of the train on the platform, and this person who was already on the track, I can still remember his eyes. He was totally frozen, and I could see the death in his eyes. Fear of death. He knew that it's over. However, somebody showed a great presence of mind and just pulled him off on the platform, and we were saved of a real gory sight. But that is the incident which is etched in my mind about how a person in such a circumstance would freeze. So again, could this be an example that a human being will only move in two instances? One is in the case where he is inspired, like let's say in the case of, in the situation of inspiration, or desperation. Many a times, as lazy people, we might just not move till we are either inspired or we are truly in a desperate situation. That it's a do or die situation. We will simply not move. Right? And that is where the subconscious mind is most active. Now, what it will do is, it will start, try to protect you. So what happens? We have big dreams. We want to do something great. The mind will say, no. Please don't do it. You will be ridiculed. You will be laughed at. You can't do this. Are you silly? People will laugh at you. You will fail. And if you fail, you will feel bad. And then there will be people in your environment who will say, I told you so. Yeah. So now, how can we work with this same subconscious mind who has all the resources that we need? Throughout. Since our childhood, whatever has come in its environment, it has registered. It has all the resources within. Of course, there are so many things, like we do when we walk on the street, there are so many vehicles, there are so many shops, all of those may not register in our head, but they are there. Right? Something which is really peculiar, something weird, it will register. Right? Otherwise, we will simply not notice. So we always have this distortion. And we will also perceive things, like if I keep my hand like this, this part of my hand, you will say your hand is dark. But from where I see it's light. You say it's dark, I say it's light. When I turn it, you see this part is light and this part is dark. Who is correct, who is wrong? Both are right. It's from where you see, from where you stand. Right? And that is how we can really work with our subconscious mind. So whenever our subconscious mind tries to tell us, whenever we are trying to do something, like I want to maybe talk in front of a group, my mind says, no. What if you are not able to deliver? What if everybody laughs at you? What if you are not able to remember anything? So what I can say, yeah, I understand, but we have tried, we have prepared. Even if we fail, we will try again. So can we have a dialogue with our subconscious mind? Can we change the words that we use with our mind? Because most of the time, there is all, continuously we have a conversation in our own head. Most of the time it is negative. Right? And does it take the same effort to think negatively as it would take to think positively? Right? It would be the same talking. It will just be positive. But because we are used to negative talk, it comes naturally.
Mind is conditioned.
How?
Because of the past experiences and the environment around you.
Right.
What we see, what we learn.
Right.
That same thing goes inside. And nowadays we see mostly people talking negative.
Yes. Why do we see mostly people talking negative?
Because they have been brought up in that atmosphere.
Thank you.
Upbringing is something that affects their behavior.
That's
lot
right.
A lot of factors
are there.
All that, the mind gets conditioned and the person behaves accordingly.
Thank you. So that's absolutely right. So since childhood, we are conditioned, right? And we are programmed or we are trained like that. And who are these training factors? Our parents. Don't hold a glass. Yeah? It'll fall. Don't do this, you'll fall. Don't do that, you'll fall. Yeah, all the time. Then the news. When we watch the news, what do we hear in the news? Everything negative. All the time. And nowadays the news is so dramatized. So all that drama, we are so much going to register in our mind, because it is all going in the video or video and audio form in our own minds. And we also get that feeling, newspapers, what kind of news? So what is it that we are filling ourselves up with? What is it that we are programming our minds with? That is going to be prevalent. And then all the time we are fearful. So our watchman is alert. Our subconscious mind, our watchman is alert. Don't do this, don't do that. For most of the time, in my case, when I had this broken ankle, I thought I can't do this, I can't do that, I can't do this. So I have actually a group of monkeys to thank to put me in that situation of desperation where I had to act. My way out.
No way out.
Does that also prove, sir, that the problems, seeming problems that we face in our lives, are they the opportunities to really grow? Can we look at the problems that we face as an opportunity to grow?
The one thing that comes in the way is the fear.
Yes, fear, because that is our inherent. Yes, so that is the subconscious mind. How to get rid of the fear? Face the fear. Face the fear how? I am faced with this particular situation. What best can I do in this? If you have the time, great. Otherwise, the subconscious mind is any which way is going to take care. But again, if when we consider one point, how are we programming our mind most of the time in our lives is what is going to determine how we act at the crucial moment. Because if I am a negative person, I would have simply stood there and died. Yeah, I could have been bitten by the monkeys like so many people were, and I could have, that would be the end of my life, or I would have been somewhere in the hospital with my daughter. But I wasn't. I was strong. I had to protect my daughter no matter what. That was my thought, that I will protect her. And the next step which I had actually thought is I had almost picked her up and I was actually starting to go in circles so that with her sport shoes I could hit those monkeys. So I had a plan of action immediately. Where did it come? Within fraction of seconds? From my subconscious mind. Because by that time I had started associating myself with much positive things, with faith that I can overcome so many things. So how?
Faith is the antidote.
Absolutely. And faith and fear can never coexist.
Yes.
When you have faith, there is no fear. Absolutely. So one of the components, how can we really reprogram our subconscious mind? Replace fear with faith. So first and foremost is faith. Faith in ourselves. Faith in any God, anything that you believe in. And if you are really, whatever your modality, and today, like never before, we can hear so many negative things in this world happening. And equally, if you see, even in this health talks, if we see, so many times, there are so many different modalities that are being presented here. There is so much of alternate medicine, there is so much of angel therapy, so many alternate therapies. Where are they coming from? Why are they coming? Why are they emerging so much? Because there is so much of fear. And to combat fear, faith is also working overtime. Do we see that around us? Right? And now, all we really need to do is really, really use it to our own advantage. What are we doing to make use of it? So faith, whatever, wherever our faith, whether it, through the prayers that we do, whatever religion, really doesn't matter. As long as you are spiritual, your religion really doesn't matter. Whatever you do, even if it is faith in your own self. Basically, ultimately, everything boils down to faith in your own self. Do I believe in the God within me? Do I believe in the Buddhahood within me? Do I believe in that godical, as Vishen Lakhiani puts it? I am the particle of God. So, godical. Exactly. Absolutely we are. Right? So, what is it that we really believe in? Where do we place our faith? And whatever works for us. we can really, really every day reprogram us ourselves with that. So faith, whatever works for you, meditation, prayers, chanting, anything that works for us, let us do that. Another amazing way of really programming your own subconscious mind is gratitude. So when we are talking about our subconscious, conscious and subconscious mind, when we come to look at this iceberg of our mind, this is the alpha state, which is the expanded awareness. Now this state, when are we in this state? One? Okay. So yeah, absolutely, when we are totally relaxed. And most of the time, when are we relaxed? Either when we are in the meditative state, or there is one window when we are just about to sleep. When we switch off the lights, we put our head on the pillow and we are about to sleep, yeah? Just before going to sleep and just before waking up in the morning. Getting out of the bed, I meant, thank you. So just after we wake up and just before that time, the time between getting out of the bed and waking up, yeah? So that is the time we've just opened our eyes, or we've just come into consciousness that we are awake now, and now we have to start the day. Now most of the time, how do we start the day? We just start running. Yeah. So mostly with women, or even with men, they have to rush for the office and all. Women, they have to kind of pack the tiffins, the lunches for the kids, this, that, their timings.
So they look at the clock, what is the time?
Exactly. So that is what we start doing. However, those are the timings when we are in this alpha state. Just aware and still in the subconscious level. And that is the time when we can actually program. And Dr. Wayne W. Dyer's expression of this particular thing, I really love. That is, throughout the night, we marinate ourselves, marinate our brains with whatever we think last. Right? The last thought stays in our mind the entire night. And sometimes, because of that, sometimes we have nightmares, or sometimes we have great dreams. Right? So how, what do we want to marinate ourselves with? What kind of thoughts do we marinate, or do we want to marinate ourselves with? So many a times when we lie down in the bed, that is the time when we start thinking of what happened the entire day. This ne ye bola, this person said this, that. So most of the time we recap the entire day. And many times a lot of negative things also. Instead of that, if we can really develop a habit to feel gratitude for whatever happened all day. Just like there are negative things that happen all day, there are also a lot of positive things that happen all day. So if we are able to really be grateful for that, and with that gratitude if we speak, so gratitude is a very healthy emotion. It's one of the healthiest emotions. Where you can't feel grateful and sulk at the same time. When you are feeling gratitude, your heart is always in a positive state. When we are thinking negatively about something, we are automatically shrinking. Our soul is shrinking. Can we feel that? We can feel that anger, we can feel that resentment about that person. Somebody said something negative about me. So I'm feeling and reliving it. A person might have said one thing and left and forgotten. Maybe they didn't even mean what you perceived. But what have we done? We've just held that thought, nurtured it, made it really big. Keep making it really big every day. That this person said this thing to me. Make an absolute mountain out of it. And for all you know, the person even didn't mean what you perceived. Right? So sometimes we distort a lot of actions. Right? And instead of that, if we, while sleeping, if we marinate our own minds with good thoughts, gratitude about all the good things, maybe say a prayer, and also the part of faith. Another very nice way
so you
is
can
to
also think of some 10 positive points that are gratitude.
Yes, absolutely, 10 positive points. In fact, journaling is a very, very good way. If you are not able to think about something, just write down, start writing 10 good things that happened to me today. Write that and then switch off the lights and lie down. Right? And if our mobile is going to be the last thing that we see, let us also use it for our advantage. We can maybe play some good music on it. There are so many YouTube meditations, guided meditations. If you are not able to sleep, if your thoughts are troubling you all the time, put on some guided meditation. Or put on some music which soothes you, something nice. Or in your own voice, record for yourself. There was one person I came across on YouTube. Nowadays there are so many tools, we can actually use the technology to our own advantage, you know. She had put up some music and on her own phone with that voice recording thing, she had recorded a lot of affirmations to herself. She had actually taken her own name and she said, oh, you are fantastic, you are great, you are awesome, you are the perfect weight and you're doing great in your business. So, you know, with that kind of lot of zest, and she was really enjoying saying that. So, another thing, with the gratitude, while also journaling about positive things, feeling joyful. Find things where you can be joyful, which make you smile, which bring in the child out of you. What is it that you can do? What is it that you like to do? It would be so wonderful to do it. One of these days, I saw one of the videos right here in Help Library. There was this young girl who had conducted this laughter yoga session. And it was so amazing. I was looking at all the participants. Everybody enjoyed it. It is as if the child within them had come out. Right? It was such a wonderful session. And one simply couldn't stop laughing, couldn't help but smile. Isn't it such a wonderful thing? Can we find people like this? Can we find people like this in our environment? And if there are no people, we can find them on YouTube. YouTube is the Pandora's box, a magician's box for all of us. And speaking of magician, when the magician says abracadabra, what does it really mean? What I say becomes true. And that is what happens. What we say will always be true. Whatever you think is right. So if you're thinking negative, you're right. If you're thinking positive, you're right. You absolutely manifest your own thoughts at all the times. Like Mr. Proctor says, if you can see it in your head, you can have it in your hand. And don't we have examples of this? This camera, this mic that I'm speaking into. Was this there once upon a time? It is somebody's idea. The washing machines that wash our clothes at home these days. Even my maid has a washing machine. Everybody has those plasma TVs these days. Where was this television? I have seen black and white television days as well. Color TV came in front of me. The plasmas have come up. Where did these come from? These were somebody's idea. And I'm sure when they must have mentioned it to someone, they must have been ridiculed. Is it not? People must have said, what rubbish? This is just not possible. Wi-Fi, not possible. Now today, we can actually explain God with the example of Wi-Fi. It's become so easy to explain God to kids. We tell them, you can't see the Wi-Fi, right? You still get the internet on your phone. You see little kids, like even my my son, when he was even 6 years, 7 years old, he would like, Wi-Fi, 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 Wi-Fi. Wherever they get the Wi-Fi connectivity, they go to the mall, wherever they have this free Wi-Fi, they are like literally looking for free Wi-Fi everywhere. These small kids also. So when we try to understand the concept, we try to explain the concept of God to them or faith to them, Wi-Fi has made it so much easier for us to explain this concept to children these days. It's just like Wi-Fi. You can't see it, but it gives you internet connection, right? Internet accessibility. It's just like that. Where were all all these things. These were somebody's idea, which were definitely ridiculed at one point, but they did not give up on their dreams. They did not give up on their idea. They did not give up to the ridicule. They did not give up to the watchman who must have filled their hearts with fear. They told the guard, "Don't worry, we'll take care." Yeah? So let us find a lot of moments of joy. Gratitude, journaling, joyful moments. Let us really, really find a lot of joy and make those. Because when we are joyful, this watchman, he's okay, he's fine. He said, okay, everything is all right. These people are happy, enjoying, there's a lot of laughter, there's music, so everything is fine. The moment our hearts start gripping with fear, the watchman is alert. You need me to save you? Do we need to run? How can I save you? The watchman becomes alert. So we need to quieten that watchman. There are so many instances we see that when we really, really, sportsmen, look at the sportsmen. Even if they're injured, even if they're really badly injured, they will get up and run and go. How many people have seen this Shah Rukh Khan's movie of this women's team, Chak De India? Wo 70 minute. The way, nobody can forget that dialogue. Ye 70 minute. These are your determining 70 minutes. You go and win or you lose. Nobody is, we are not actually going and playing. Even those actors did not go and play. But when we watch that movie, aren't our hearts filled with pride? Aren't our hearts filled with, yes, I can do it? If we watch these motivational movies, motivational videos, motivational anything, our hearts are also filled with motivation. Our hearts are also filled up with possibility, that this is possible. So let us find ways to really continuously, what is it that we are putting in our head is something really, really important all the time. What kind of people do we associate with? Do we associate with negative people all the time? Then it's time to change. It's time to change the company. Because it is very comfortable. Really, really very comfortable. And there's a saying, if when you shoot for the moon, you will at least land somewhere between the stars. But if you, yes, at least in the middle of the stars, if you don't try, you're not even going to get off the ground. So there is this example of a fish who swam through many seas and oceans and somehow landed through a little tiny hole into a well. And there she met this frog. And she said, "Do you know how huge the world is? How huge this ocean is?" He said, How big? This big. She said, "No, it's even bigger." "How big?" "This big." No, it's even bigger. I just swam through it and came." She said, "Even beyond these walls, it's bigger than these walls." I said, "What rubbish. It just can't be." He started laughing at her. "The ocean cannot be. The entire world is between this wall to this wall. There is nothing beyond these walls." So are we those people who see nothing beyond these walls? Or are we those people who have the courage to venture beyond those walls? And are we associating ourselves with the people who do not see beyond the walls? Or are we associating with people who see beyond the walls? What kind of books we read? What kind of movies we watch? Everything determines what kind of people we are becoming every day. So a crisis, or even money, but there are so many misconceptions with money that people say that when rich people are bad, or rich people are this, or somebody who started from humble beginnings, he became rich and he became bad. So money does not make people good or bad. It simply magnifies their inherent nature. So good person becomes rich, will continue doing good. A selfish, negative person becoming rich will continue doing bad. the same thing. So what is it that I am driving after? What do I want money for? Do I want money to show someone down? To fulfill my desires? Right? So if I want money to fulfill my desires, and if I am able to be happy now with whatever I have, then when I have whatever money, whatever things that I want to have, I will still be happy. But if I am not happy today with what I have, it's good to aspire to have more. But we must also be content with what we have and happy where we are, value what we have. But if I am not able to be happy today, no matter. I know a neighbor of mine, there was this, when this Skoda Octavia, when it was launched, it was a huge thing, and they were a young couple at that time, and all they wanted was, we want that Skoda Octavia, it is this, that. She would be so happy, she would be just dreaming about it all day long, literally. There was no other topic she could talk about. And when the car actually came home, she said, it's there in my parking. It's mine now. What's the big deal? It's mine now. It's my possession. So that entire excitement was flat now. All that excitement that had built, so now it will be something else. So is my happiness depending on a Skoda or something else? Mercedes or whatever. My son names some fantastic names which I never remember. Bentley is one of them, and okay, whatever. So I won't even go there. All the models I can't recollect, but all these fantastic cars. So even if you know, you're not going to be happy if you're not happy today. Even when you get all the cars in your garage, you're not going to be happy. Richness doesn't guarantee happiness, right? And we can be rich or poor, again, only limited by our own subconscious mind.
How you feel inside
is most important. How do I feel about things? What is it that I am feeling about things? That is the most important thing. So all the time, what is the radar that we can check ourselves with? Our feeling. Let us always check. Now sometimes we say, that the voice in my head says this. What is this voice in your head? Let us all the time keep questioning, checking with ourselves. Question this voice in the head. Assess whether this voice in the head is the voice out of conditioning, or it is that genuine voice which gives you goosebumps. Check the feeling. Does this voice excite you, or does this voice pull you down? Is this the voice in my head of my parent who says, it's like a overprotective mom. No, don't do this. Don't do that. You'll fall. And what happens with don't do? Let us do a little example of don't do things. Okay? Let's see what happens. Now, please don't pay attention to your legs or your feet. Please don't feel any feelings. Don't feel how they feel on the floor. Please don't pay attention to your feet at all. What happened? Right? You feel only the feet, right? But I was saying don't focus on your feet. Why did you pay attention? Now what happens? Till I knew this funda, I wish I had known it few years back. I would have become a much better mother probably. So every mother, you will keep shouting at the children. It is like, you know, shouting at the walls. Every time. It's like, you know, as if you are talking to the walls. Nobody is listening. Don't do this. Don't do that. Don't keep the feet on your sofa. The child will keep the feet on the sofa. Don't throw your shoes here. The child will throw the shoes there, because the mind doesn't understand. Don't. We exactly. Why don't they say positive? They don't know this now, sir. How many? I just told all of you, don't focus on your feet. What happened? Feet were like that. Feet That is why we need to educate ourselves first. How can I say, don't do something, don't drop the glass, dhaad. We yell at the maid, don't break the glass. The poor thing, she will get so scared, she will just drop the glass.
You are bringing that thing into your mind, the focus.
Absolutely.
Now you say, don't kick your leg, you are bringing the leg in the picture of the
Absolutely.
The picture of the leg in your mind.
Absolutely.
Which was not there before.
Which was not there before.
That the picture arrived.
Yes.
So
you
say, no.
Yeah. We see many places on the street, don't spit. It's nicely colored with the spit right beneath it. Don't leave your shoes here. There'll be a huge collection of shoes right under that sign. So, yes. Yeah. Please remove shoes here. Please do this, do that. Clear instructions. You might just be surprised if we try. If we try the opposite, we might just be surprised. Because first and foremost, see, sir, how easy it is for us to point fingers at others. What am I doing? See, as a mother, I need to reflect continuously on my own self. How many times does it happen? We tell our children, don't tell lies. And sometimes when the doorbell rings and I don't want to meet somebody, I tell them I'm sleeping. What am I teaching my child? What am I doing?
Knowingly.
Absolutely knowingly. And what is that child learning? That it is okay to tell a lie sometimes. But when the child lies to me and I find out, I want to crucify my child. Tumhari himmat kaise? How dare you? Is this what I've taught you? In the mind, the child must be saying yes. Right? So there are. It's about time we change our language if we really want to see the changes within our own selves. Simple examples, yeah, and we can replace them with positive instructions because our brain follows our instruction. So, with using this reservoir of the subconscious mind, if this intelligent mind controls this subconscious mind instead of the other way around, will it not be amazing? And if we make the subconscious mind our own ally, by putting its fears to rest, that don't worry, I'm enjoying this. Even the pain, I'm enjoying. That's what many soldiers do. On YouTube, now I don't remember the name of this general, he has actually, there is this video where he has said, begin your day by making your bed. You know, when you begin your day with making your own bed or cleaning your own bed, that is where your proper training starts. That is the first sign of your discipline. That is how we discipline ourselves, because we are also made of our habits, right? And then he has narrated, towards the end of the video, he had narrated that during their training, there is one particular training where they are supposed to stand in the cold water, chin high. And it's really very cold, and just the heads are up, and their seniors, because it's a test, it's a training that they have to pass, and the seniors, they're trying to tell them, give up, it's okay. They're actually encouraging them to give up. And in this biting cold, they had to stay there about 6 hours or 8 hours, something like that. And they were just standing there, and these people, they're encouraging them to give up. Why do you want to do this? It's freezing, it's really cold, you'll fall ill, all these things they were saying. And then, all of a sudden, one person, he starts singing loudly. One person starts singing, everybody picks up. And off tune or whatever, whichever way they could, with chattering teeth perhaps, in that freezing water, they all started singing. And that is how they could survive that entire night, and obviously the entire batch passed with flying colors. So how, in whatever the circumstances, whatever the external circumstances, how we imagine them or what we make them up in our own mind will determine the outcome. So for that voice in our head, let us continuously ask the questions. What is that voice in my head saying? Does that voice in my head fill me with fear, or does it fill me with excitement? If it fills you with excitement, it is the correct actual voice in your head. And if it is the voice in your head that fills you up with fear, it is the voice of conditioning. Don't listen to it. By ignoring it. Consciously ignoring it. You can if you decide to. If we associate ourselves with positive people, if we associate ourselves, if we are only eating good food, we will always invariably be healthy. If we are following proper routine, daily routine, we will be fine. When I was much younger, 18, 19 years probably, I was in a college in Pune, and my routine at that time was, I used to cycle down to the ground, take three rounds, I would jog three rounds, and then I would run up the hill, watch sunrise, and then come down. And when I used to go uphill, there was a gentleman, 80 years old, who used to run up the hill with me. Me 18 year old, he 80 year old. And I still remember his face. I don't know his name. We would just smile and say hello. We were uphill running friends, you can say. But I have his image in my head. What an amazing person. At 80, he was matching the running speed of an 18 year old. Who could beat such a person? And just imagine, such a person, does he need to retire? So in one of the interviews, there was one young person who was interviewing Mr. Bob Proctor. He said that what is that one thing, you're not 35 or you're not even in your 40s. What is it that makes you go to work every day? So he said, people who retire are not living their lives of their dreams. If you are doing the work that you really, really love doing, there is no retirement. There is no end to your work. And then it is not even work. It is your passion. It won't make you feel tired. It is your passion. You will still dress up and show up. There are so many people. There was one gentleman who was one of my neighbors. Every morning, as if he is going for work, he would wake up at the same time, he had the same morning routine, would take a bath, dress up as if he's going for work, in proper suit, shirt, suit and everything. It was so amazing to see him. He was such an inspiring person. He's been such an inspiration to me. So many good things that I know, so many good authors that I was introduced to were introduced by him. He would actually mingle with so many youngsters like me and would give proper direction to us, and he was so amazing. He had that energy. We wanted to listen to him. He was not the person, okay, aa gaya uncle ji bhashan dene. People don't like people who try to tell them, do this, don't do that, do this, don't do that, you should be doing this. You should be doing is so boring. How many times have we told us, you should be doing this? Have you ever done it? Because I should be doing this. But when it is, I want to do this, then it becomes easier. Whatever I want to do becomes much more easier for me and much more exciting than what I should be doing. So let us begin with
inspiration.
Absolutely. That precisely. So we move only in the state of inspiration or desperation. So should we wait for desperation, or should we look for inspiration? What is it that excites me? Like, if I give my own life example to you, I woke up at the age of 40 all of a sudden, and I thought, till then I kept on blaming the entire world for my problems. I thought my children are very small, they need attention. I could have used alternative ways to do things, but I just kept waiting and wasting my time and blaming. The situation hasn't changed. My younger one is still 9 years old. Really, the older one had her first board exam today, but my younger one is still 9 years old. I still have the same limitations. However, here I am.
See, here lies the main problem. Yeah. What happens, you know, people most of the time, focus on finding faults with others,
yes,
and blaming others,
yeah,
instead of focusing on their own self, trying
absolutely
to find out their own weaknesses and
absolutely
making sincere efforts to overcome their own weaknesses so that they can rise in life.
Absolutely.
So that same energy which they waste, they can utilize in the life.
Absolutely. So what one can do is, one good thing is I was introduced by in my younger age to so many authors and also, and I love reading, so luckily I kept reading good things, so that was one good thing. However, I could have done much better with my life and made the lives of people around me a little less miserable. But sir, like you said, it is very easy for me to sit here or stand here and find faults with each of you, and likewise
but you can always do it.
Exactly. Because this is easy, right? What is difficult? Looking at myself.
Rising is difficult. Falling is not difficult.
That's very easy. Falling, you just let go. Rising, you have to climb the steps. Absolutely. So, but that effort is worth it. If you want to fly in an aeroplane, when the aeroplane takes off, there is maximum air pressure. And the air pressure is also there when a child is trying to take the first step. That's why the child keeps falling. But the only when we face that air pressure is when we soar high in the sky. Is it not? So how do we really associate ourselves? How do we show up every day in this world is what will determine the outcome of our own lives. That is how we will write our own story, and then our subconscious mind will become the miracle factory which churns out the best version of our own self. Till then, we will only keep churning out excuses. However, when I understand that I have all the resources in this world, then all of a sudden, everything starts moving. All of a sudden, the right kind of people start showing up in my environment, the right kind of opportunities keep coming in my way, the right kind of support starts flowing in.
So why does that happen? When you think in that direction, why the things flow?
Okay, there's one very beautiful saying, I love quotes, okay? Attention goes where energy flows. Energy flows where attention goes. We are all energy. Everything is energy. So what happened when I asked you, don't focus on your feet? Energy started flowing in that direction, wherever our attention went. So that is why your feet all of a sudden became the prominent part of this world, right? So attention, energy flows where attention goes. So all of a sudden, where is my attention? Everything is working for me. And then everything starts working for me. From within I am feeling. From within when I believe. See sir, whatever I am feeling, do I really, really believe? How will I know that I believe it? When through visual, audio and that kinesthetic feeling, when it registers to my subconscious mind, only then will things in our life start moving. If it is on the surface of the conscious level, things will never move. And that is why people say, I make a lot of effort, but still it doesn't happen. I keep trying, but still things don't move. When anyone or when we catch ourselves saying this, that means we are functioning only from this level. We have not tapped here. We have not reached here. And this is the source of all our actions. If I want to give you a small example, every morning when you wake up, please notice this. Every day when you get out of the bed, if you are a righty, you will always put your right foot down. When you reach out for your toothbrush, you will reach out for your toothbrush only with your right hand. Right? So let us, who is functioning? The subconscious mind is taking care of this. Consciously you are not saying, right, that I will put my right hand out and take my toothbrush. When I put my foot in my shoe, I'll first put my right foot in. I'm not doing it consciously. It is now on the autopilot. And who takes care of the autopilot? The subconscious mind. Okay. The subconscious mind, the entire thing, the programming you can start doing here. You can go down deeper in theta. The delta is the deep sleep time where you are and the healing time. So these two stages, the alpha and the theta. So when you go in meditation, you are in the theta level. That is where you start getting sometimes those intuitive flashes, right? And that is also the record of the memory. So everything is again stored there. So mainly theta, and the programming can be done at the alpha level. This particular part, yeah. Visualization, through visualization, through bringing in those positive habits, really rewarding oneself, enjoying your new habits, is what is going to really reinforce the new habits and the new way of life. So when we actually go through this, when we are able to replace fear with faith, when we are able to replace everything with healthier habits. So gratitude, journaling, being joyful, finding ways to be joyful, associating oneself with people who uplift you, consciously making that effort, very, very important. Consciously making that important, finding the tools. There are umpteen tools these days, and that is what my training company we do that, explaining the power of subconscious mind. That is why when I coach somebody individually, that is what I try to do, because so many times we are limited by our own limiting beliefs. Nobody else limits us more than our own selves. So let us really, really understand and really, really do our best. And I would like to leave you with one very beautiful quote, which I am recently pondering over. This quote is by Bill Gore. If I want to be free, I got to be me. Not the me that I think you think I think I should be. Not the me that I think you think I should be. Not the me I think my wife thinks I should be. Not the me I think my kids think I should be. If I want to be free, I got to be me. And for that, I better know who me is. Absolutely. So, thank you very much.
Thank you.